Shiori Ito, welcome to the program. What we saw here, you giving a press conference, talking about rape, and accusing a man for raping you. That's quite unheard of in Japan.
It is.
What were the reactions you got from the first there?
Well, first of all, talking about sex or even, I mean, rape is so taboo, and we have quite a strong stigma in Japan. So I knew it won't be easy to talk about it. But that was the only way to make some change. And the outcome was quite brutal, I have to say. I couldn't go back to my own apartment for 3 months, and I got some threat, death threat, and quite negative comment. And
what about your family? It must have been difficult for them as well. How did they react?
It was quite difficult for them, and they didn't want to me to do it in the first place, of course. And but I had to tell them, well, then who's gonna do it? And I was always thinking about my sister. I don't have a child, but for me, she was always like my daughter. And thinking about if this happens to my daughter, it scared me. And, you know, so I had to keep repeating myself, this, it has to happen now, and talk about it now.
And I mean, talking about that kind of experience, talking about rape, is always difficult, but even more so in Japan. Why is that?
Yeah, why is that? I think it's been quite, our historical and social background is a big part. But what I realized was that it was about a year ago, I published about groping story, because as a girl growing up in Japan, that's everyday life. Especially when you're in high school, when you're wearing this uniform on a train, you are always target. So I wrote about it, and it was for some foreign media. But then when it was translated into Japanese, I got a big backlash. So I knew it is just taboo to talk about sexual assault or sexual violence in Japan.
Because if you look at the numbers, it's like that kind of that kind of crime doesn't happen much in Japan, if you look at the numbers. And
exactly. So I think it was 2013 survey. Mm-hmm. It says that 100,000 population in Sweden, I heard it's like 58 or 60 rape cases happening here. In UK, I think it's about 40 cases happens, mm-hmm. but in Japan, it's only one case is happening. Why is that? And I've been doing some research, and it seems like only 4% rape victims go to report to police. Just because we know what's gonna happen during the investigation time. So just giving you some example, what I experienced in police, I had to reenact with life-size doll what had happened. So I had to lay down on the floor. There were 3-4 male investigators.
This was when you reported the rape?
Mm-hmm.
So you had to reenact it?
Mm-hmm.
With a doll?
With a doll. So when you know these kind of things happens, it's quite hard to go. And also, my first reaction going to police, they said these things happens a lot and it will never be investigated or prosecuted, so we can't deal with you. I'm sorry. So that was the start. So it's good that they finally took the case, but still, it took over 3-4 months to do all whole investigation.
It was back in 2015 this happened, and you went to a dinner with a well-known journalist, and you were going to discuss job opportunities, right?
Well, that day he actually offered me work, and it was in America, so he was saying, well, let's talk about how we can provide you a working visa. So that was why we met. But the last thing I remember was being dizzy at this sushi restaurant and waking up in a hotel room. So I don't remember much of it.
And in his hotel room?
Yes.
And that's where it happened?
Mm-hmm.
He denies this, of course, as you are very well aware. He did that very publicly and denies any wrongdoing. And also now the criminal case is closed.
Yeah.
But you're being persistent. We talked about persistence here today, and you didn't give up.
The reason why I had to talk about it in last May was because that was a chance to pressure the parliament, because they were talking about changing the law, which hasn't changed for 110 years. Our rape law didn't change for 110 years. And before, if you steal something, you would go for jail for about 5 years. And if you rape someone, you would go to jail at least 3 years. So 110 years ago, objects were worse than, I guess, women. And so...
This is kind of a structural problem in the society, in the Japanese society, if I understand you right. Mm. How does sexism in Japan look compared to sexism in the Western world?
I experienced growing up since I was little, and it was just a daily thing, and no one really questioned. I talked about it once I was growing up in a swimming pool to my mom. They didn't say anything, and I remember my friends of my friend's mother say to me that it's because I was wearing bikini. I was 10 years old.
You were swimming.
I was swimming, and that shocked me as a 10 years old that, oh, that was my fault. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I never questioned about sexism in Japan, but now I strongly do because I was shocked.
And you strongly did so before actually Weinstein and the whole Me Too thing, and some called you the first Me Too case in Japan. Has that hashtag and that campaign had any impact in the Japanese society?
Well, I want to believe so, but it hasn't been big movement yet. Rape was never reported in Japan. In media, it was a taboo word to use, so they always used the word of tricked if it was a child, if it was down to underage child. This is another thing. Our consent for sex is 13 years old.
13 years old?
Yes. So when this happens to under 13 years old, they can't talk about it in media, so they say they've been tricked.
I mean, it's not like we don't have this problem here in Europe as well.
I think the thing that's really interesting for women now is the support they're getting from other women who are hearing them. And, you know, when this first happened, the Weinstein thing first happened, I sat down with a girlfriend of mine and said, God, you know, I was just thinking about this, and I can count 10 episodes, like, from my...
In your life?
Yeah. I could give you 20, I'm sure, but just casual groping, being followed, being, you know, people kind of touching you up when you really would rather they don't, or not say, you know, not accepting the word no, all that kind of stuff. Every single woman who I spoke to, bar about one, I think, had at least 10 things that they could recall. And when I told my husband, he was so shocked. He couldn't get his head around this at all. And then there was a very interesting thing on social media where somebody talked about the things they do that they've assimilated in their everyday life as a woman, not to get attacked by somebody. So everything from, well, I wouldn't wear these shoes if I was going out in the evening because I can't run in them, to have I got a taxi booked from a company that I trust? Have I got someone to meet me because I know that bit of a walk is dark? Am I wearing something that might look suggestive? You do it without thinking. You go through this mental checklist. And someone said, how many of these... Show this list to a man and ask them how many they do. Now, carrying your keys. The earliest trick I learned as a kid was to carry my keys through there. And I used it like that once too.
To hit someone?
Yeah. When I was a schoolgirl, I got followed home. I knew the guy was going to follow me because he was saying stuff on the bus, and I got off the bus and he was right behind me. And as soon as I felt his hand come, I did that and I got him in the face. And then I ran. So I don't know what happened, but I was very good at running as a kid. Wow. I mean, I'm laughing. I don't know why I'm laughing. It's...
You, I've seen that you describe the Me Too movement as a pendulum.
I think it might be. You know, there are some cases where I think people are using what might have been an unfortunate experience as a Me Too thing. And I think it's a really tricky thing, and I'm... Because it's so new, I think the pendulum has gone like that, and I think it will find a place to settle. But I would hate that people's eagerness to conflate their own experiences would mean that it got discredited at all, because I think it's so valuable. And I think there's something so many women I know have felt both liberated and very churned up by what's being discussed, because you're having to confront stuff that you might not want to confront. But I'd say one thing that's really heartening, might not be heartening if you're a man in Hollywood right now, but the fact that corporations are acting so quickly, and this is the first time that women are being believed. Mm. I mean, I can't imagine the bravery that you've shown coming out and doing this in Japan. I take my hat off to you.
Thank you. Your persistence has paid off in a way, because the law is slowly changing.
It has changed last year. It gave us hope that it can change after 110 years.
I know you live here now.
Yes, so that was the thing. Now I can say whatever I want to because I'm in London. Really. That gave me voice to speak, because now I don't feel very fear to go back to Japan, well, which I'm now heading off now, right now, so finger crossed.
Well, I'll be sure.
But that was great things for me, that I had a place to come and be, you know, I have freedom of speech now, and yeah, it feels great. And
Shiori Ito, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.